Hi everyone, I'm so excited to say that I'm with Emilia at Sancton Wood School and we're going to be bringing Science of Hazel to the lab, so we'll be showing you lots of practicals. Emilia is going to introduce herself.
Hi, my name is Emilia. I am a lab technician. I work in this school, Sancton Wood School in Cambridge. I am also STEM ambassador, which means I go in other schools to introduce science to the kids and we have lots of fun together. I have also an Instagram page, emilia.science, and follow me to see all my experiments and videos.
Yeah, you should absolutely follow
Thank
her.
Thank you.
That's awesome. In this video, Emilia and I are going to show you how to carry out a titration. Now, there are lots of different reasons why you carry out a titration. One could be that you want to produce a soluble salt which contains ammonium, potassium or sodium. Because of the way in which the soluble salts dissolve, you need to use a titration in order to work out very accurate volumes of both reactants. So that could be one reason why you want to carry out a titration. Another reason you want to carry out a titration is because you want to carry out a titration calculation in order to find out an unknown concentration. Now, I'm not going to talk about that in too much detail here because the whole point of this video is to show you the method used. You need to watch my alternative video on titration calculations to understand the maths involved. But what Emilia and I are focused on doing today is showing you how to accurately carry out a titration and to accurately find the volume of hydrochloric acid needed to neutralize a particular volume and concentration of sodium hydroxide, because that's really what a titration is. It's adding a very specific volume of one reactant to another, causing a neutralization reaction to take place, and we use an indicator in order to tell us the neutralization has occurred.
Okay, so we're going to put hydrochloric acid in the burette and sodium hydroxide in the flask. So I'm going to load the burette with the acid. Usually you wash it with acid 2-3 times, yeah. But this time we just do once. So the tap, of course, must be off, closed, and very slowly because it loads very quickly, otherwise it will overflow. And
notice you can carry out a titration in either way. You could have the acid in the burette or the acid in the conical flask. Just depends on which indicator you're using.
Okay, because I want to start from zero, I'm going to lose a bit of acid in the beaker and also to get rid of the bubbles that sometimes forms in the tap.
In order to avoid parallax errors, you need to make sure you read from the bottom of the meniscus, because if you look at liquid in a particularly narrow tube, you notice that it has a very curved shape, so you need to read from the bottom of what's known as the meniscus.
Then you add the sodium hydroxide to the flask, which has been previously washed with sodium hydroxide solution.
Multiple washing.
So this is 25 cubic centimeters of sodium hydroxide.
This is a glass pipette and it's used to produce very accurate volumes of solution.
Okay, then you add a drop of methyl orange.
So methyl orange is an indicator which, as you can see, turns orange in an alkaline solution. Remember that sodium hydroxide is strongly alkali.
And then I place it.
Yep, so we're ready to begin our titration. Notice that the end point, that's when neutralization occurs, is when the methyl orange turns from orange to red. The whole point of using these indicators is they have a very sharp end point. They have a sharp change in color, which is why methyl orange, phenolphthalein, they're both ideal for use in titrations. Universal indicator is inappropriate because, remember, it shows a range of different colors. So Emilia is going to open the tap and start slowly adding hydrochloric acid to the sodium hydroxide. The beauty of a burette is that it can add drop by drop. So it makes it far more accurate than a measuring cylinder or a beaker. She's swirling the flask in order to mix the contents. So we place the tile underneath the flask in order to observe the color change.
Now you have the drop, you will see it pink and then disappear.
Yeah.
So it's not ready. It doesn't mean that that is the end point, because it must be a color that doesn't disappear when you swirl the flask.
Yeah.
See? Pink starting to appear and then disappear.
So it means that we are close to the end point.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's it.
Oh yeah, it is pink.
Mm. This is the color we want.
So we've reached our end point. The solution, although it looks pink in your exam, you're going to have to say that it's red, and that means that the solution is slightly acidic. So the essential thing now is that we read the volume of the acid that was added. Notice that the burette runs from 0 centimeters cubed down to 50. So we're really trying to work out what this volume is here.
Yes, it's 25.
Yeah, so reading from the bottom of the meniscus, we can see that 25 centimeters cubed of acid was added.
So if you have this color, it means that you have been further.
Yeah.